Good afternoon. This is Dr. Dawn, PsychMD, your most influential double-boarded child and adolescent and adult psychiatrist, ADHD coach, and ADHD expert. I'm also the psychiatrist for professional athletes. Listen, today we are going to be talking about a very sad but important topic. The epidemic of child suicide is prevalent in our society these days. There are an estimated 14 deaths of children under the age of 9 that commit suicide each year. And those are the ones that have committed suicide. It does not suggest how many have attempted on their life. So today, I dedicate this broadcast to all the mothers, fathers, sisters, family members who have lost a young child by suicide. I also dedicate this broadcast to the young children who don't have a voice, whose voice wasn't heard. We're sorry. We hear your voice. We hear your tears today, because now we are educating the masses about your voice. We're educating the masses about everything that you have been subjected to. So without further ado, with special guest Dr. Kwanzaa with me today, we present to you When Kids Die Young, Forever Young. Silent at all. You know, it was filled with wails, it was filled with screams, it was filled with tears. And these were the sounds that I didn't hear when I was there with mom and dad on earth. You see, I'm only 8 years old. I had a very short life. I remember when I was born, my mother and my father were very happy. They were very excited. I was their little baby. The firstborn. Mom had bought me everything, prepared months and months before my arrival. And I remember Dad, he took off work and was just as happy as my mother. And then here comes the first day of school. 5 years old, and I'm very excited to meet all the kids and just to see who from my neighborhood is going to be in my class. And yes, so excited. My mom brought me a new backpack. I had my new lunchbox. Yes, I was ready. I was very ready for school. I wasn't anxious at all. I was very excited. I didn't sleep the night before, I remember. And then I went to school and I met Miss Hall, my teacher, and I met some of the kids in my class. Everyone just looked at each other, though. You know, we didn't really talk much. But I thought that that would actually get better. I thought that people would start talking, at least to me. And then I noticed they stopped talking to me more and more. And I felt, well, why do you don't like me? What did I do wrong? My mother always told me that was a cutie pie. You know, I thought that would get friends. But that wasn't, it wasn't easy. It wasn't an easy experience at all. I remember one day, I was looking in my backpack to get my homework out. And Benjamin, you know, the kid that sits behind me, he took my homework and just tore it up in front of me. And I said, what did I do to you? Why did you do that to me? He just laughed. And then Stacy laughed. And then Sarah laughed. And then Mark laughed. And then all these kids were laughing at me. And I worked hard on my multiplication tables. I don't understand why they took my homework. And then it happened again in the lunchroom. When I went to the lunchroom and I looked around and I saw people just staring at me. You know, this is like 20 days into school. Why are they staring at me? When other kids just go up to the tables and they start talking to each other, laughing, giggling. And here I am alone at a lunch table, eating the lunch that my mom packed for me. And no one sat with me. I felt so alone. This is just not right. I don't understand what I did wrong. And then that day came in January when I was going to the restroom and it just brings tears to my eyes. He hit me. He made fun of me. He called me names. And I didn't understand why he did that to me. He punched me. He punched me real hard in the stomach, in the face, in the back. And then I fell backwards. And I lost my footing. And then it just went black. And all I could remember is that I was in a nightmare. And I could hear little voices. Look at him just sitting there, laying there. Oh, he thinks he's so cute. No one likes him. He doesn't have any friends. Oh, look at his pants. They're too short for him. Yeah, look at that afro that he has. I mean, I just heard these little voices, but I couldn't see them. It was just black. I thought they were my friends. Well, some of them at least. And then it just went white. I went home and I just couldn't stand being ridiculed and talked about any longer. And I thought about this for a couple of days, and I didn't know what one of my friends, who I thought was my friends, told me, just kill yourself. No one likes you. You don't have any friends. No one plays with you. Look at you, how you look. You're ugly. You're dumb. Kill yourself. Kill yourself. And like, but why? What did I do? But then I thought, well, maybe I can just go to sleep for a long time and maybe I can just wake up from this nightmare and everything will be okay. They will be my friends again. They will want to play with me. So when I got home, I went to my bedroom and I didn't know what I was doing. I mean, I didn't know what they meant by that. I looked it up on the computer to see what that meant, what suicide meant, what killing myself meant. And there were other kids like me on there. We didn't have a gun in the house. My dad didn't believe in that. My mom, she was scared of them. We didn't have any medication in the house. I mean, just Tylenol, but I didn't know how much I should take. So I got the idea from Janet, this little girl, and she just took a rope, a jump rope. She put it around her neck, and it hung very high from the ceiling. And she got on a chair, and that's all I remember. I think I did the same thing. I just can't remember. But now I just hear the wails. I hear the tears. I hear the tears of my mom crying out for me. Mom, I'm right here. I want to come back. I see you crying. I'm so sorry. It's my fault. I didn't mean to do this. I'm sorry, Mommy. I thought I could go back. But all I can see is looking down and see my mommy and my daddy. I didn't tell them. They didn't hear my cries. They didn't hear my voices at night. I kept it secret. Because I didn't want to get in trouble, but I didn't want to tattletale. Then they would make more fun of me. But I guess that's it. I mean, I'm happy where I am now. I think, I don't know. This is very new to me. I just want to grow older and live out the dreams that my mommy had for me. But I guess for now, I'll be forever, forever young.
Bullied most of his school career. When he hit high school, it exploded. He didn't fit in with a lot of the crowds. He wasn't into sports. He was into hunting and trapping, which not a lot of kids his age are into. So he had a hard time finding kids who had common interests with him. So that made him a target a lot of the time. It started out with words. He was called just horrible names. It progressed to having trash thrown at him. He was punched in the stomach. He was made to lick a bus window. He was jumped from behind walking to the buses. He was ridiculed for the music he listened to. You name it. They looked for any little thing just to make his life miserable. When he was jumped walking to the bus, The boy told him the night before that he was going to do it. He said to him in a text, "Why? I know you don't like me. That's why I don't come near you. I don't have any interactions with you. I respect that. Why can't you respect me? What have I done to you?" His response was, "Because you're a pussy and you need your ass kicked." It makes no sense to me even today. One of the kids that Daniel had a lot of issues with had texted him. I saw the text myself. And it said, "Why don't you take one of your precious guns and do the world a favor, go kill yourself." He texted that same kid and he said, "You won't have to worry about me anymore. I'm going to go home and kill myself." And he said, and the kid came back with, "Put up or shut up." That day he told people in lunch, he had told people in his classroom, told a number of people on the bus, that he was going to kill himself. Those were his words. "I'm going home and I'm going to kill myself." And the bus driver said, "I'll see you tomorrow, Dan." He told the bus driver, "You won't see me tomorrow." The one person he knew that would do something was the last person he texted and the last person he called, his hunting friend, Matt. He knew Matt would try to call us. And he said to Matt, "Please don't call my mom. My mom will take me to the hospital." He was trying to keep Daniel on the phone, get his sister's attention. He was writing her notes and having her call their father, who's a friend of my husband's. And we missed the call. We missed the call. We came out of Michael's basketball game, and my husband, Rob, said, "I missed a call from Kale. I'll call him when I get home." Next thing happened, literally within a minute of saying that, so our other friend Wally calls. Now, guys don't talk to each other all the time. And Rob runs to the van. And he said, "Daniel's talking suicide." called my next door neighbor and I begged her, go over and check on him. And she walked in the door and she yelled, Daniel. And she thought she heard him say something. And she shouted out, we love you. And then she heard the shotgun blast. And I ran to his room, and the sight that I saw was horrific. It was horrific. And
historically, we didn't feel that kids could be depressed. Kids? Depressed? Sad? Tearful? We didn't feel that they could be depressed. And the psychiatrist and mental health professional studied this a little bit more. And we found that kids can be profoundly depressed. How do we know? Because we started to understand the development of kids. We looked at their cognitive development, their psychological development, their social development. And we could understand why they could be depressed. It's not how we would feel as adults. Kids have a different way of thinking at different developmental stages in their life. And so when we're talking about kids, I'm referring in this broadcast who are 8 and below. In our society, in 2014, there were 14 kids that completed suicide, which means that they ended their life. Now, that does not reference how many kids attempted suicide. A psychiatrist at Yale School of Medicine, who's over their inpatient ward for kids 13 and below, actually reported in 2015 that in their inpatient ward, there was one patient who was under the age of 13 who attempted suicide every day for 3 months. This is horrific. This is real. This is not something that you see in a movie. Yes, even kids as young as 5 have taken their lives. Today, we are addressing this issue because we can no longer ignore it. We must talk about it. I'm sure there are a lot of parents who have joined this broadcast today who has a kid that's younger than 10, younger than 13. Or maybe your son and daughter 16, or maybe you're an adult who've experienced a suicide attempt and still struggle with depression. Now, depression is one of many reasons that places a kid or an adult at risk of wanting to end their life. There are other risk factors, there are signs, there are symptoms that kids younger than 13 have discussed with mental professionals such as myself. Of what they're feeling, what they're experiencing, and their outcry of them telling people that they want to end their life, that they want to commit suicide. They don't necessarily say that. They'll actually say they want to kill themselves, but not be taken seriously. Why are we not taking these kids seriously? You've seen some stories, a few stories. You will see other stories pictured of young, beautiful children, innocent, yet struggling, challenged by life's stressors, by genetics and what they're predisposed to, by what they've experienced at such a young age. Social media, bullying, depression, divorce, isolated from kids. These are some of the many risk factors that kids have experienced at such a young age that actually result in suicide. So today we are the voice of Gabe. We are the voice of Daniel. We are the voice of the thousands of children who have ended their lives. They're speaking to my heart. They're speaking through Dr. Kwanzaa's music. We hear your voice. We hear your cries. Today, we will be talking about why kids commit suicide. What are the signs that we see in children that want to end their lives? Are they the typical signs that we may see in an adult, a teenager, a man, a woman? Well, here are some of the signs that you may find, especially as a caregiver. You know your child the best, okay? So when I talk about these signs, first of all, I want you to recognize if there are any changes. Changes in how they function. And I'm talking about across all levels. Changes in how they socialize with their friends. Changes in how they communicate with you. Changes in how they sleep. Are they sleeping too much, too little? Changes in how they eat. But recognize that there is a change in their functioning. And oftentimes, it's a change that's not healthy. So that's number one, okay? Number two, crying spells, sadness, depressed. Oftentimes, kids don't know what depression is. You won't hear that word out of their mouth. But you may hear, "Mommy, I don't feel good today. My tummy hurts." Good afternoon. This is Dr. Dawn, Psych MD, your most influential, double-boarded child and adolescent and adult psychiatrist, ADHD coach, and ADHD expert. I'm also the psychiatrist for professional athletes. Listen, today we are going to be talking about a very sad but important topic. The epidemic of child suicide is prevalent in our society these days. There are an estimated 14 deaths of children under the age of 9 that commit suicide each year. And those are the ones that have committed suicide. It does not suggest how many have attempted on their life. So today, I dedicate this broadcast to all the mothers, fathers, sisters, family members who have lost a young child by suicide. I also dedicate this broadcast to the young children who don't have a voice, whose voice wasn't heard, that we're sorry. We hear your voice. We hear your tears today because now we are educating the masses. About your voice. We're educating the masses about everything that you have been subjected to. So, without further ado, with special guest Dr. Kwan. With me today. We present to you, When Kids Die Young, Forever Young.
Sitting in a sandpit, life is a short trip to me.